But, you know, it's a little bit somber because some of the people that bought tickets and some of the people that would love to be here have lost friends and families in that terrible, terrible infamy. So it would please me and it would please family if we can all stand up and give 1 minute silence. Easy to leave your home and come and gather on a Saturday evening where you probably would like to spend some time with families. However, there are certain issues that do make us to make a move and go somewhere, sit down, network, meet people, discuss issues that affect us and the whole atmosphere. My name is Kate Anole, popularly known as Auntie Kate. I actually love that very, very much. I'm a mother with four children. I've been brought them up myself alone when my youngest one was only 18 months. That youngest one is the photographer that's running around. And she's a mother now. And one of my sons is here. Meshi, can you stand up, show yourself? That's my son. He's an artist. And I think he said this evening he did some photos for a picture of people. You know, so if you're brave enough to sit quietly for him to caricature you, please do so. That would be wonderful. I worked as a midwife for a very long time, 35 years. Within this time, raising my children up, I struggled. But that struggle wasn't in vain. It was a struggle that helped me to do what I'm doing today. And that is empowering women. It is through that empowerment that I went into politics. Why did I go into politics? Because as a midwife, there was a lot of questions coming to me from families. And when I want to answer these questions, I had to go to a pot, and that pot being the council. And at a point, I asked myself, this council, the people working there, have they got two heads or one head? I noticed they've got two heads. And I said, okay, I've got two heads as well. But when I got there, they all got one head. And I said, yes, I've got one head as well. That means I can do what they're doing. That means nothing is impossible. That means if you set your mind up, it didn't matter what you are, whether you are single, whether you're married, whether you're divorced, whether you're separated, or whether you never at all. There's nothing impossible and nothing can stop you from doing what you want to do. Nothing at all. Because I've tried it and I found that whatever I wanted to do, that I'm able to do it, despite the children. The children were there, four of them. I was there full time and I was also studying. And I studied and I got my degree in law. And that's when I knew that I can do things that will also help others. And that's why I embarked on empowering women, talking to them about leadership, talking to them about loving themselves. I'm a very, 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 very proud woman. This is because I have nothing to lose. I would actually lose if I'm not happy about myself. That's when I start to lose. Because life is only but short. And we don't own it. When you think about those people that lost their lives in the fire. They would have been planning something to do in 10, 20 years time. And that was cut short in a very horrible, horrible way. But we have to continue to live. So when I got into politics, I found that this, yes, this is the right place to be. But women don't know that. Women think that politics is only for men. I don't know how long I'm supposed to speak now, you know. And so I found that, if we leave it to men only, we will never be able to address women issues. Women issues are so important, and it will only take a woman to address a problem, because she says the person that wears the shoe knows where it pinches. So as a woman, you know that if you need a maternity leave, then it has to be you that needs it, because you need time to nurture a little baby and to let the baby grow with you, and you go to know your baby before you go back to work. But if you're not there where the rules and the laws are made, nobody will speak for you. And that is what I thought. All my life now, what I want to do is to continue to empower women, to continue to tell them that politics is good. Politics is good for women. Politics is good for everybody. But if one woman goes and becomes a political leader, it will change that person only. But if a lot of women become leaders, it will change policies and politics. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Felix. Thank you very much. I'm now going to introduce our first guest speaker, Councillor Christine Hamilton. Sorry, the worshipful Councillor Christine Hamilton, Mayor of Enfield. Now, I have a long piece of your distinguished career. I'll let you read a part of it. You were elected as a councillor in Enfield 7 years ago. Since then, you have been a cabinet member for 3 years and served as the deputy mayor. You are the current mayor of Enfield. You thoroughly enjoy contributing to a positive change for the citizens living in Enfield, and you hope to make more inroads during your mayoral year. Thank you, Councillor, worshipful Councillor Christine Hamilton.
Caribbean and Asian women in politics in the UK, promoting equality, educating women in policy making and legislation. So where do I see examples where we have such good politicians? In Enfield. In Enfield we have Kate Osmar, MP for Edmonton, who was re-elected on the 8th of June. And one of my roles on the 8th of June was as returning officer. I had to announce this with a straight face, and I had to calm down. I wanted to cheer because she won with such a good majority, a raised majority, and I was delighted that I could stay very calm and just do the announcement, which is what I did. And I must mention Amber Shalalambox, just because he is our first Greek Cypriot MP in London. And I think the second one in the country. We have in Enfield, we have Crystal Fonionga, a councillor and cabinet member. She was educated in Enfield and is now a barrister. A fantastic example to young women about how to develop and work through the system. My deputy mayor is here with us tonight, Doris Jagg. And we even had a chat in the car coming up today about inequalities, about leaders, leader of the council, leader of the party, and I talked about a lot of way forward about how we would look at and address some of the equality issues that we know we have always got to be aware of and back in the corner. Of course, I met Councillor Necker Kisa when we came in, who's an associate member, and she's brilliant. And Councillor Yasmin Brett, a cabinet member on Enfield Council. And I'm really proud of the women that we've got on Enfield, and a lot more women. I think, again, we worked out we are over 50% women on Enfield Council. In May, we had a by-election at Lock where a male councillor stepped down and we selected a woman and she was elected, so that's taken us to 51%. So we're really, really pleased about that. So I really do look forward to hearing more about the forum. So this group is now where we in Enfield and around the country must work to your objectives and increase contribution from African, Afro-Caribbean, Asian women to politics in the UK. Just one of your objectives, to build up a community of thoughtful women leaders and innovators in local and national government. I agree with this 100%. As a woman from a northern working class background, I understand how the support to help women increase the level of confidence needed is important, and that this group, your group, is going to be working hard to achieve it. This is what your group is working to. It's fantastic. There's so much talent and ability around us. And we need to mentor and support young women to recognise their ability and knowledge, then give them the help and understanding on how to work through systems and through the blocks that crop up at many stages. As an active promoter of encouraging women, it is great that we can raise women's profile and motivate members to strive and achieve changes in politics, inspiring leadership, management, public speaking, and building self-confidence, and improving self-esteem. I send you all my best wishes, and I hope you all enjoy the rest of the evening, and thank you for inviting me.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to invite Kate back up here to just for 5 minutes to do a recognition of the full leadership team. Thank you.
worked so well. Yeah, we've worked so well for some time now. And when we launched this in 2015, we launched it in the House of Commons. And our High Commission did tell the representative who was so impressed. And the team were called back to the High Commission Commission. And he said, that's one thing he's always wanted, that's Kapiga, the one that just gone back. He said, one thing I'd always wanted to do was to have the African, the Asian, and the African Caribbean, you know, ambassadors together, the High Commissioners together, which he never did. He never managed, and I managed to do that. On that basis, I took the opportunity and said, well, if we do something nice, what about being our patron? He said, why not? So it's nice to say that after our patron is the Nigerian High Commission. And because of the inauguration, and we did some reshuffling, just like Theresa May did last time. We did some reshuffling, and we think, unfortunately, our former chair is not here. She might be still coming on her way. But I'd like to call the team, the present team now. And if you can all come up, please, and show yourself quickly, and then we can then move on. Could I now call on Dr. Pauline Long, who is now chair of the FOB. Councillor Mineka Kizo, can somebody take over? She is the first vice, and then Mrs. Christian Adamu, second vice chair. We have a global director of project management and secretary, Mrs. Yetunde Adeshina. We have our assistant secretary, Kenne Onyeka Alison. We have our Director of Media and Publicity, Ms. Felicity Okoro. We have Director of Event Coordination, Mrs. June Douglas. And we have the Director of Newsletter Production and Public Publishing, Mrs. Shola Salako, who will be seeing her. And we have Director of Operation, Mrs. Jenny Okafor. She is coming on her way because the needle has something to do with, you know, they are sorting out. And then we also have a Director of Policy, and who is at the moment, Chinelo Anyanwu and Miti Tohama are just holding on the seat. And Tohama had to travel this morning to Japan due to a family issue. So at the moment, these are our team. So I think, I need my glasses. Oh my goodness. We have our Global Director of Policy, Dr. Justina Mutale, is all here. I didn't ask for my glasses, you see. Yeah, thank you. So sorry, Dr. Justina, it's all here. I'm so sorry. Yes, these are the team, and it's this team and a new team that we need to take forward. And I'm sure later on the chair will be speaking and tell us what is expected of us or what he's planned for us. So if we just give the chair, and I can say thank you so much for, and in fact, almost all of you been there with me all right through. And I think you realize what we are trying to do. Because if you notice, you might say, but some of them are not politicians. But do you know that a politician and a leader is the same? It's just the other ones decided to be in the politics, making the legislatures But who are the leaders? The leaders are the ones that really make things work. Because the politicians sit there, they don't really know what is happening. So this is why I make sure that I don't just have councillor, you know, I have everybody, you know, and they're not just some of them, I'm pushing them to go into politics itself and be politicians. So, and I'm working hard on this, and I think I'm winning as well. So, I'm sure the photographer is taking some photos of us. So let us just quickly, because we have things to do, you know. Can just somebody just get Councillor Kisa? Please just ask her to come fully for 1 second, please. Jackie, if you don't mind, you can mind the table for her, please, yeah? Can we have soft music while we just wait?
Yeah, because
say themselves who they are. I think it always sounds better coming from the horse's mouth. Yasmin Breck. Professor Joe. He's not here yet. And Rani Malik. Okay, so we'll welcome Professor Joe to the front when he wants he's here. But in the meantime, we're just going to start with all the panelists that we have, and we'll start with. I don't talk and sit down at the same time. Okay, so can we just appreciate all our panelists for the first time? I hope you're all prepared for this. Surprise, surprise. Okay, so I'm going to hand over to Rani, and she's going to tell us a little bit about herself and what she does.
Hi everybody, lovely to see you all, dressed so beautifully as always. My name is Rani Malik. I'm a mother, I wear a lot of hats, I'm an entrepreneur, I support a lot of women who have been through domestic violence. I support women to come out of their comfort zones and, you know, become something and, you know, be financially free, because once you're financially free, you can actually breathe better. Even though your husband's very supportive and stuff, but it's nice to have your own identity, it's nice to have your own ability. I'm also a host on a chat show where I call people who have been through, you know, personal obstacles in life. I also interview people who are trying to make awareness, raise awareness. I've interviewed people from Malawi, Sierra Leone, and I really appreciate the way the whole world is turning to diversity. I mean, we're here today to promote something, and in the way that bringing different communities together and helping each other, that's why I've got a lot of connections with the African diaspora, and I feel really proud to say that we are all brothers and sisters in this, and you know, I think it's fantastic, and I'll further that as well. So without further ado, I should be
how worshipful the mayor, the deputy mayor, all protocols observed, and distinguished ladies and gentlemen. My name is Justina Motale. I wear a million and one hats. I don't know which, but for purposes of this this meeting, I think I'm going to focus just on a few. To start with, I'm the founder and CEO of the Justina Motale Foundation. We focus on getting women into leadership, into leadership in all spheres of life. That includes the political, the business, the society, the environment, science, technology, and everything else that comes with that. Because we also work with the United Nations, and we are trying to help the United Nations to achieve the aspirations of getting the 50-50 planet, where we have women to sit on the highest level of decision making in politics, in science, in business, and in everything else that I have mentioned. And with that, with the foundation, we have a scholarship program, of course named after myself, the Justina Motale Scholarship, and we offer scholarships to underprivileged but very highly academically talented young African women and girls to access higher education, to go to universities around the world. We have partnered with several universities around the world who are making that possible for us. I'm also a civil society delegate to the United Nations Commission on the Status of Women. I am a delegate to the African Union High-Level Panel on Gender Equality and Women's Empowerment, to which I'm traveling to on Monday. And 2 weeks from that, I'm going to Mauritius to speak at the Education Forum, organized by, the African Union and the government of Mauritius. I am also the global envoy for the International Women's Think Tank. With that, we take critical research and try to find solutions for young women and girls, how they can find and navigate their way through trying to achieve the 50-50 planet. There are so many things that I could talk about, but I suppose I cannot go into all of that. But I could just mention that on top of all of that, I am a humanitarian. I am a global official of Dignity. It is a platform that recognizes the greatest humanitarians of the world. Global Official of Dignity, and for sure that is GOD as in God, and that has heads of state. It looks at what heads of state are doing to empower humanity and to maintain peace in the world. So we have heads of states, rulers, and everybody else. For some reason, I found myself there. Thank you.
My name is Andy Love. I was the Labour and Cooperative. And the reason I mention Cooperative, I'll come back to that because it's quite important. I was a Labour and Cooperative Member of Parliament for Edmonton from 1997 to 2015. But in regard to this conference tonight, probably the most important thing that I can say about my time in Edmonton was that I fought the election in 1992, the first time I had been a candidate. We expected to win. Everybody thought Neil Kinnock was going to be the new Prime Minister. He didn't win, and I didn't win. But I didn't go away and insulted. Well, not for too long anyway. I got back on the campaigning trail, and 5 years later, with Tony Blair, we managed to win a fantastic result, and we were in for three terms. That's always got to be uppermost in your mind at times like we're living through at the moment. The Labour Party is there to deliver for the people, and they must keep that central view at all times. I mentioned the cooperative movement. For those of you, I suspect there's not very many here because it's only a shadow of his former self, but the cooperative movement is famous for bringing on its women members. Women made up over 70% of the membership because it was a retailing organization that managed to empower women through its own structures, its democratic structures, and through that to involve them in politics. And there's many, many examples of women who were early pioneers in Parliament who started out life in the cooperative movement. I'm here tonight really as much because Kate Annan, who happens to be a very good friend of mine. We've been political soulmates for a very long time. I had the privilege and pleasure of being one of the two speakers at the inaugural fall conference in the House of Commons. And I said there that evening, I felt just a little bit alone on the platform because I was the only man. I look round tonight and I see very many more men. And that seems to me an essential truth in all of this, which is that women's empowerment is a man's issue. We can't do without them. We have to persuade those that are recalcitrant. But through that, women will take their place by natural selection. 50% of all our representatives at every level, in every organisation where power is distributed, will be women. That's what we're here to empower, and that's what I am dedicating myself to. I looked at the conference, a very successful conference in the House of Commons. It reminded me that equal opportunity is at the core. I'm sure we'll get on to discuss this tonight. Equal opportunities is at the core of what we have to achieve. The one area we're making very good progress, I'll finish on this point, we're making very good progress in bringing women into Parliament. We've made substantial strides. We're even making strides in bringing people from the Bami communities into Parliament. What we've utterly failed and achieving as women members of the Abbey communities in Parliament. That's what we must dedicate ourselves to. That's what this organisation is in business to achieve. And let's hope we can set the groundwork as well for achieving that over the coming years.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
My name is Yasmin Brett. I'd first like to say thank you very much for inviting me here this evening. It's a real honor and privilege to be amongst you all. I would also like to pay tribute, while I have the chance, to my colleague and sister, Kate Annaloo, who I have been serving with on the council, who I've worked with on many important causes, such as we worked together to get the transatlantic slave trade recognized in Enfield Council and a plaque put up. I think we are one of the few that has this plaque. And also to get slavery debated in Parliament, particularly modern day slavery. And I have my colleague here, Christine, as well, with Kate, and we got the first, we got a big piece of work done into gangs and young boys, and that report was recognized again and won an award. So we've had many opportunities to work together, and I'm wishing Fawke all the best from here, and I know anything that she's involved with will be a great success. As for myself, what can I say? The women's empowerment issue. Today, I have with me my mother here. And I'd like to say that I was thrown into politics from a very young age because my family were involved in the independence movement of Bangladesh. And my mother was the only woman in a crowd of, I'm not joking because this is substantiated by a newspaper picture, in a million people when they announced that Bangladesh should become an independent country. And they started fighting for it. And I used to see her motivating people around me, and particularly women. And this, in my mind, raised the issue of us becoming active politically. I was about 14 at the time, and the other friend I had was a BBC. And there was a man there who used to come out, John Stonehouse, he was the MP. And he supported Bangladesh, this Labour MP. Anyway, to cut a long story short, I got involved in the idea of women and politics. And then, as a student here in England, again, I worked on that subject, women and politics. And then I started working within different communities here, particularly the Turkish-speaking community in Islington, where I helped set up an organization called IMECE, which is still active. It works specifically with women who are suffering domestic violence. And at that time, I was involved in finding safe houses for women who were experiencing domestic violence. We used to meet with women, and they would take on any of these women who unfortunately had a bad experience and placed them there in safety. Many of these women were from the garment industry at the time because the garment industry was very, very big all along the east of London. I used to work with these women, helping represent them as well. And then from there, I met somebody called Margaret Hodge, who is still the MP, and she got me involved in local government. She gave me the push. She gave me the idea, and I was in the Labour Party already from 1984, and I found myself within local government. And now, you know, I've served as mayor, I've served in many different roles, and now I'm the cabinet member for culture and leisure, and the women's agenda is still very close to my heart. We held two women's conferences, which went, we would think, very successfully on the issue of women and art and women and science. And we got schoolgirls along to those conferences, particularly the one on science, where we were motivating young girls to go into STEM subjects at GCSE, the science subjects. And we know that some of them did following that conference, because getting women into science is highly important, and you have to do it when girls are young. So this is a little bit about me. I'm wishing hope very well, and I'm particularly glad that it is a combination of the Afro-Caribbean, African, and Asian communities. They're all Commonwealth country people who have a common experience, and we can work very well together. We all have English, many of us have English. We are going to be able to be helpful to our sisters from other communities, particularly who come from Eastern Europe and Europe now, to also raise their issues.
I think you'll all agree with me that I'm sitting here and I'm thinking I'm not even worthy of sitting here at the moment. But you know what, the journey you have all started and are doing, I'm happy to say that I'm on that journey now. It's the beginning, but I can see the bigger picture. So I just want to, first of all, appreciate you all for what you've done and for even being here to honor this occasion. I just want to say something based on what you've said before. You said you wish for well. You are part of Form, so you're wishing yourself well. So we are all part of Form as of tonight. I think I have permission to say that.
Yes.
So if you thought you were here to honor FORB, you're actually here as FORB members. So it's a lifetime thing. We don't intend that the people that are here this year will not be here with us for the rest for many years to come in the future. So we are all part of FORB. Yes, we are wished well, and we hope that we'll be able to take the battle forth and make a bigger impact in the world as we go on in the future. So based on what we've heard, does anybody have any questions for any members of the panel?
As you get older as a woman, you kind of start realizing that it helps to get involved. How do we, or what do you think we need to be doing to get those kind of behind us to get involved?
Thank you for that question. I forgot to mention that before I ventured out on my own, I worked in the gender section of the Commonwealth Secretariat, trying to fight for gender equality, of course, and also gender mainstreaming in the Commonwealth. I've got to mention one thing here, that working in the Commonwealth and working on gender mainstreaming in the Commonwealth, we suddenly found that while in other parts of the world, we were trying to get women to come up and reach the men, in the Caribbean countries, actually, it is the boy child that we needed to bring up to be at par with the girl child, because the women in the Caribbean are more advanced at that point. I don't know how it is now, having worked in the Commonwealth for about 10 years. But at that time, we found that the Caribbean boy child needed to catch up with the Caribbean girl child. I have also studied international relations and politics and political science, and I have written a number of papers on women's representation in politics, I've just done a book where we were talking about getting women on board, and I had to give it's only an international perspective, and I had to focus on the African perspective of how to get women on boards in business and in the economy. I've got to say that I have always had a very vested interest in the case of women's leadership, because I come from Zambia in Africa, and I think most African countries might agree with me, but because from my part of Africa, especially from my family, I come from women who are very strong, powerful, and assertive. Somebody told me perhaps I shouldn't use the word assertive, I should use aggressive, because on my mother's side, a woman has always ruled the kingdom. And in fact, when I was quite shocked when I grew up, because when my country gained independence, our new government, led by our own African leaders, embarked on education for all, and for both male and female children. So in my family, we didn't have to choose who went to school. As long as you were due to go to school, you did go to school. And for me, that's where I think the issue of gender equality came from. And when I grew up and I found that there was a problem that some families had to choose when sending children to school, to choose between a girl child and a boy child, and normally they would choose a boy child, I didn't experience that. So that surprised me. And so growing up with all those very powerful women, the women that ruled the kingdom in Cruz, still rules the kingdom in my mother's family. And also from my father's family, although we it's patriarchal, we had one very powerful, assertive, perhaps aggressive woman that just rose up and started this movement that took almost 200,000 people when my country only had a population of 2 million people. So I grew up knowing that women were natural leaders. And I could also see in my household from my mother, she ran everything in the house, deciding the budget, deciding who does what and what, while my father went away to work. And I think, as they say, charity begins at home. In my mind, in the way I have grown up, and in all the issues that I've had to deal with, gender equality, sometimes I find myself struggling that for so many years, women have been fighting for gender equality. When I look at all the affirmative actions and initiatives, for example, by the United Nations, the women's suffrage movement, we moved on to the Beijing platform, we had the CEDAW in 1979, the United Nations Conventions on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, 1979. 1995, Beijing Platform for Action, talking about gender equality. We have, skipping that 2000, we have the Millennium Development Goals, highlighting gender equality and women's empowerment for 15 years. Now we are in the post-2015 Sustainable Development Goals, still highlighting gender equality and women's empowerment. And last year, I looked at the World Economic Forum. They had a calculator, a gender equality calculator, which indicated that both by the standards of Zambia and also the UK, you have to key in your citizenship and all that, so I put both Zambia and the United Kingdom, I'd have to be about 150 years before the world can achieve gender equality. And I'm thinking, what is going on? What is holding women back? Because from time immemorial, in my mother's group, women have always held on to their name. When you are born as a girl child, you have your own name. You do not take your father's name, you do not take your husband's name when you get married. That gives a lot of self-awareness, self-identity, and a power to yourself. And I've been working on all these initiatives, the United Nations, the African Union, and all that. And when you look back, you think women have always been leaders in Africa and in other parts, when you think that they control the in the community. So where did the separation come that the leadership of women in the community and in the home cannot go into the public sphere, into the politics? Because women are always looking for a win-win situation where if your children are fighting, you always have to remind them, this is your brother, please do not kill him. He was wrong to do what he has done, but you need to get on and this and that, and you find you do it that way. So it really does puzzle me in the world that I found myself in. And that is what, I haven't gone into politics, although I have studied politics, but because I am a humanitarian, I fight for peace, and also I fight for empowering humanity through women's empowerment. Thank you.
Anybody else? Try to look behind me. Anyone on this side?
This way.
Oh, we're going to answer as well. Okay, sorry.
I will just very quickly answer that question, which was about youth, how we can encourage youth. Well, you would probably all agree with me that in this previous election just gone, we had a record number of young people come forward and vote for the first time. And, excuse me, I found that enormously encouraging, whether it was the whole issue around Brexit, whether it was the whole issue around the charisma of Jeremy Corbyn, I cannot say, but certainly youth came out in record numbers. Now, what can I say about those two things? I had the privilege of working in our schools here in London. And one thing that I noticed with our school children is the fact that a lot of them are very, very engaged in political debate and are interested in politics when they are at school. Because there's a lot of debates that go on all manner of issues within schools. But what happens when they come out of there, and between then and the age of 20, I am not quite sure. There is something that happens that seems to switch them off. Now, as somebody who is actively involved in politics myself, young people, I have to say, they want honesty. They want people who will deliver on what they say they are going to do. They look for politicians of this sort. Now, I'm not saying that all of us as politicians don't deliver anything or that we don't do anything, but there's something going wrong with our communication, I think, or there's some kind of gap. So I feel we need to address that issue. Whether it is that we use the media that young people are using, which Jeremy, for example, used very effectively, Snapchat and so on, whether it is that has been successful, I think that is one way forward, but also actually listening and taking young people's views seriously. Because young people today are challenged in a way which I would say probably I was not. I think the lives that, particularly in London, that young people have to deal with is very difficult. There is some knowledge about the insecurity of what the jobs are, the lack of jobs. They know from their families, a lot of them, that their parents are working so hard now, maybe doing two or three jobs, that they find the communication issue is becoming a real issue for the young. So I feel we have a lot of work to do there. And, you know, FOP, there's a lot of young people in the community that we work with Kate and Christine here, whom we know about. I think we need to go back there and ask those young people what they feel now and where we can take them forward.
I'm in total agreement with that because young people have a mind of their own. So we can sit here deliberating and say this is the best way forward, but actually with young people nowadays, the best way forward is to ask them what it is and what is going to get them into politics.
My name is Dr. Mrs. Victoria Lagomeji. And my question is really about, is in line with the previous question. How do we reach out to the grassroots of women locally to get them involved in, for instance, politics? And also, not just politics, but supporting them, empowering them, and getting them involved in what's going on within their communities. So reaching out to the grassroots women around locally is one of my questions. How do you do it? And secondly, my second question goes beyond local mobilization and reaching out to local people locally. But internationally, I think you've touched up on the women education of girls. How do we change the mindset of people in of people in power to prioritize girl education? Because it's still happening that when it comes to it, in families, due to economic circumstances, if they have to choose who to send to university, it will be the male. Whereas the female is sent out to get married earlier, at the age of 12, or even earlier, and not being allowed to even achieve secondary school education. It's still happening today. So how do we reach out internationally to leaders to ensure that girl education is prioritized?
Okay. Hi. The way you can help get women together in the community is talk to people, organize little events. Could be a coffee morning. Somebody might know somebody who might be interested in talking. It's all about building a relationship with people in the community. Organize little coffee mornings. I'm in talks at the moment with a lot of people from the Pakistani community, and they all want someone to talk to. They don't realize that there is a life beyond the comfort zones, and the only way they're going to find that life is if they communicate with people, and if they find out that actually, you know what, I find when I talk to people, they say to me, how did you do it? I said I did it because I just don't stop talking. I talk to everybody and anybody, even on the train I can talk to somebody and have a really long conversation, and I go back and I even exchange numbers, then I meet him up again, and then it's what you can deliver. It's all about listening, it's all about talking to one another and finding out what they want and how they want to come out of their comfort zone, and then how you can work together and, you know, do that. I have a friend here today, her name is Razia, she runs a beautiful organization called Wages. She's just over there, and she does a lot of organizations, she does a lot of things. You know, she got a lot of criticism for it with everything that's going on with, you know, the terror thing all around London. But she still stood her hands, and she stood in different areas, and she did iftaris, dinners together, and she brought the whole community together. There's people from all different types of communities, and I think she deserves a round of applause.
We've got literally less than 5 minutes, so I'm going to take one more question.
I know that during the US presidential elections, Hillary Clinton used a line, "This is for all the girls out there." But this is a line I had used earlier in 2014 when I did an interview with the Because I'm a Girl Because I'm a Girl campaign, and I say, because I'm a girl, I can be a president or prime minister or anything that I want to be. That is because of where we are coming from. We are talking about women, African, Afro-Caribbean, and Asian women in politics. And this is a section of the world community that have already had women heads of state. You were talking about Pakistan. We talk about young people wanting to see role models or hear about role models. Pakistan already had a
woman Prime Minister, Benazia Bhutto, you have to remind the young people that we're not perhaps born by the time that Benazia Bhutto was there, to remind them we've had Indira Gandhi, we've had the lady from Sri Lanka, Gunasekara, herself and her daughter both became prime ministers. In Africa, we've already had Helen Sirleaf Johnson, we've had Joyce Banda. So we have to bring these role models to the fore to show our young people, especially our young women, that it is possible, it has already been done. And even in the UK, we've already had Margaret Thatcher. We currently have Theresa May. Of course, the US are struggling behind us. They've never had a woman president for up to now. But we shouldn't be, that should not be our yardstick. We have to show our young people that it is possible. It has been done before by women from your own countries. In Africa, we have our own women's suffrage movement. We have Yaa Santua from Ghana, who led the War of the Goldens too and fought with the British for the Goldens too. We have the Igbo women of Nigeria also fighting with the British. We have the South African women marching to the Pretoria buildings. Africa, Asia, and Afro-Caribbean. We've had my friend, Simpson Miller, Portia Simpson Miller. She's been twice Prime Minister of Jamaica. So all these are role models and encouraging stories that we can tell our young women to get involved into politics.
For me, I think it goes a bit more than telling. We need to support each other because it's I think it's a bit, it can get lonely up there, being the only woman in politics, not only in politics, in leadership, in power, in any position in an organization. So I think the support we give to each other is quite important.
Thank you for the opportunity. My name is Kenny Tomini Johnson. And I can relate to what you said earlier about we are moms being a role model. Because right from a young age, I watched my mom rising up to be vice president of then Better Life for Rural Women for People Who Were Nigerians. And all through the past, the thing that resonates with me that's still the same today is that for you to rise above certain level as a woman, you either give up on your marriage or your children. And this is me that is, for a young woman like me, who is quite passionate about family values, because I believe family is the bedrock of every society. Sitting down among, you know, I am 90 here this evening, I feel, okay, I'm not going to politics. I'm stepping into the shoes of leaders, and with the voice of young women like me, not just me now, I'm still under 40, and I'm speaking for women in my age group now. What is the words you've got for us to say, we can keep this going, and we can still keep our family? Because at the end of the day, after all the success, I for one will still want to have someone to celebrate it. Thank you.
I'm just going to take all the questions and then we can just, I'm going to get Andy Love to answer it because we just need to hear from him. I think he's sitting there once women thinking it's better to probably be quiet when women are talking.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. So, let me just start with an example of something that happened some few years back. We set up a business and investment summit. And we went all the way to Nigeria to invite some very, you know, successful women. We also brought the wife of a governor. And the purpose of it was that we had the general session for everyone. We then decided that we wanted to also mobilize the women to get into business. And that was the agenda, purely to mobilize the women to get into business. Guess what happened? We invited the women to steer the event. And we had about 600 women at that breakfast meeting. At the meeting, the women started talking about feminism. They started talking about activism, about how they've been oppressed by men. And this can show you why we are where we are today with women. Because we overemphasize the fact that women are struggling, you know, we overemphasize gender equality as if it's a forever problem. When in actual fact, it shouldn't be a problem anymore. So if we want to genuinely mobilize women into politics, we need practical action. We need to be more focused. We need to forget about all of this activism, because activism is never going to take us there. That's the reality. The reality is that there are women who are doing very well. Women have, you know, so we have a committee now planning another summit. Within our committee, we are 32. And you'll be surprised that the women within this committee are about 25. And the most active people that are moving this committee are women. So what are we talking about? So it means that women need to change, you need to change this style a little bit. We need to be more practical. We need to mobilize women. For example, in the UK, and I can use that as a very good example, if you want women to participate more in politics, then reach out to women. It's as simple as that. We should forget about all of the past injustices. We should limit all of our activism about how men have suppressed women. We should forget about who takes what name. That's not even the issue. We should now, now we have a member of parliament here. I'm sure you have a lot of men within your constituency that will not even get into that position. So let's focus a little bit on how we can put practical action to mobilize women into politics. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Juliet Yakapila. And thank you very much, our learned friend, Mr. Bibo. But I'll touch on that for a second, because I still have to challenge him on his statement. So please allow me to challenge him on his statement, because I feel that men need to know that women are underrepresented across the world in politics. And because of that, I will challenge my good learned friend on that at a later stage. My question is how are we going to get involved, all of us? And especially, let me tell you, I wear the hats of many hats, but in politics, the underrepresentation of especially the African and Caribbean women is really down. And I sit down in a lot of places, in meetings after meetings, and I see the English European asking and even sometimes wondering what can they do for us to really be proactive. And because of that, I yearn, and thank you so much, Auntie Katie, because she has supported our program from day one, UK Africa Diaspora Forum. And in every single occasion she's come to our event, she has insisted, and I tell you as the founder of UK Africa Diaspora Forum, that the need for women and decision making is important. She said this in our event on the 7th and the 8th of April. So I will stop there, but my question is, how long will it take you, a black African woman? We are in United Kingdom. Nothing stops us from entering any politics. So please, your challenge here tonight. What will the message for the mayor, who is wearing her crown here today? And I really thank her for doing that, because it takes us a mileage. So please, give her a round of applause and thank you. Thank you.
Okay. To say very quickly that there is this second session where you will have the same opportunity to ask a different set of people. So I'm just going to take one more person, and then it's dinner time. And no, it's dinner time. And if I either answer Auntie June or I listen to. Okay. All right. No, it's no. Sorry. You have to wait for the second panel. I'll make sure you go first. Okay? So,
write down the question.
Okay, yes, you can write down your question and we can take it later. Or you can wait and ask it in the second session. Okay, can we just give our panelists a round of applause? I just appreciate them for everything that they've done and said. Thank you so much for sharing your experience. I do still, with quick permission, want to hear from Andy Love because he's been very quiet.
I knew if I sat here silently, I would get caught. Let me say one thing. I travelled when I was a member of Parliament to Africa on a number of occasions. And when you travel in a parliamentary delegation, you fly in on the airplane, you're met by a limousine, you stay in a five-star hotel, and you go out and meet the community in set formation as to how the government of that particular country wants you to experience their politics. And because of that, I put in volunteers for voluntary service overseas. I went to Cameroon. And what I was doing was introducing, the program that I was involved with was introducing decentralization, local government into the political structures in Cameroon. And what struck me, I was there for 3 weeks, living in a village. What struck me more than anything else was at a local level, women were the activists in all shapes and forms about all issues. I found myself, I was meant to be receiving local, the people who had been elected to the local town council, but I actually spent all of my time going around on diplomatic missions, receiving delegations, receiving motions, and hearing horrid, terrible stories about the AIDS epidemic that was currently underway there, about the failures of the government in all forms to deliver for those communities. And all of that was signaled by women. I never met a man once who had a political view, but I did meet some of the people in the power structures and at regional and national level. It was exclusively men. And what we need to do in Africa, from my experience, is to decentralize power away from the central bureaucracies, away from the regional overlords, and deliver it to local communities, because that's where women really come into their own. And I think that I had the great privilege to meet with the local mayor and his chief executive. The chief executive was a woman, the mayor was a man, but very much attuned to local circumstances. And they were a great inspiration to me to come back and say to people in London and my constituency, you need to organize yourself like the women in Cameroon, because they were doing a fantastic job in representing their communities. Let me turn briefly to the issue of how do we get people involved. Well, I come to this, I have to say unashamedly, from a party political perspective. It is the way in which democracy is ordered and the way in which power is diffused is through political parties fighting elections and winning. And so it's incumbent upon those political parties to pick up on local issues, on regional and national issues, and to allow people to express their opinions and to influence the way that decisions are made. There are different ways in which you can come into politics. You can either have a local issue that really gets a hold of you and you want to make a difference, and the way you do that is through politics. You can have a community activism. You can have a single issue, somebody that's interested in the environment or interested in women's empowerment who thinks that they can do it through political parties. Once you're involved, with a political party, then the first thing you do is persuade people to vote. Over everything else, we have to get people to vote. And one of the lessons of 2017 is what a difference young people coming out to vote made in that election. And they were inspired and empowered by Jeremy Corbyn and the leadership of the Labour Party. And that's an object lesson to us. But once you've got them involved in getting people out to vote, then the next step is to get involved in the party structures and how you design policy, on how you run local government and how local government interacts with national government, and eventually how you can influence national government through policy structure in the local party. That way you can get involved at whatever level you choose, because it's not for everybody to dedicate their whole life to politics and become a member of parliament or a government minister. Some people want to act at a local level, feel that that's where they can best represent their communities, but make the best use of the time they have available. But having done all of that, it is, and I have to say this, it is the most satisfying job in the world. If any of you are thinking about going into politics, then I would recommend it wholeheartedly, because it gives you an outlet to achieve things and a great satisfaction when, as was happened in 2017, we actually moved forward in a positive direction. And it looks likely that in the future we'll be able to put into effect some of the policies that we decided through consultation at a local level that we would put forward as the opposition party. And we will continue to argue the case for them in Parliament over the coming months.
Okay, thank you so much. Can you all please go back to your seats? Thank you so much. We appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you. do is to talk to you about my journey. And I think before I start talking about my journey and how I became a member of Parliament for Breckenton, I think we all need to observe this general election and the result for the Labour Party. We were told when we were going into the general election that we were going to be decimated, that there'd be nothing left for the party. Now, for someone like myself who's just come into politics and only got elected in 2015, I felt, half of me felt, is this true? Or am I going to follow my instincts? My instincts was that the party was not going to be decimated. And that once we reached out and got our message out, and the media were actually listening to the leader of the Labour Party and not just listening to gossip and hearsay and disputes, which have been saturating the news for over 2 years, it became almost impossible for people to think outside of Parliament. Once Parliament was dissolved and we went out into the streets and we started knocking on doors, many people were saying to us on the doorstep, why are you all arguing? Why are you making it hard for us to vote for you? And that was something which I took to heart, because they were correct. If the party looks disunified, if the party looks like you can't even get on in Westminster in opposition, what would it be like if you were in power? Once the manifesto was written and it was released and people read it, the conversations on the door changed, totally changed. People actually started believing in the party, because the party started believing in themselves. And that is something which I would say to everyone in this room. It's not about getting into politics. You're already in politics. Every day is political. Every single day, everything you do is political. There is nothing which separates you from politics, because your life is political, especially people of colour. Thank you. Now, things changed, the result changed, a lot of things for many people. As we speak, Jeremy's in Glastonbury, talking to young people, listening to young people. It's not about young people coming to where we are, it's we need to go where they are. We need to communicate in the language which they feel comfortable in. And then you start to educate people about the political process and how it's important to join the party, join the trade union. That is something which we don't talk about enough. I was in the trade union before I was in the Labour Party. The trade union is the place where I learned my politics, because I was working every day. And if you're working, you need to have your rights intact, because most employers, if they could get you to work for free, they would. Now, without the trade union, many of us wouldn't even have the minimum wage, or even have a wage, or even know what your hours will be, where you'll be sitting when you walk into the workplace, whether you'll have a seat, which is your seat, or whether you'll be sharing it with someone else. Trade
union. I'm just being... We would really like to ask questions. I've had one or two people ask questions. So can I suggest that if you could please sit down, and I'm going to invite two other people to sit with you. So you finish what you're saying, and then we get to ask your questions.
Okay, well, I could say to you is that it's very important that we're organised, and that if you're asking me to come and speak, which I'm very happy to do, so it's done in an organised way, because I was just doing what I was asked to do. I think there's more to it, then I'm very happy to sit down and to share the floor.
I completely agree.
So what
I am very grateful for your indulgence. I completely agree. And this is, we're kind of doing things a little bit, one or two people were expecting to have a show now. Yes. So you are helping us out. And you're as a thank you for your indulgence. Felicity, you two, if you can please come and sit, you will introduce yourself.
why don't we open it out now to questions, if that's what you'd like?
Struggle.
because women cannot do that on their own. So it's really important that you may make comments in jest, but in seriousness, you must support women, your daughters, and, you know, women at large. So I have to slightly tell you more. I'm sorry. No, we just said.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And to Kate, especially to you, good evening. Thank you for organizing this and putting this together. My name is Felicity Okolo. I'm a member or director of Hope, as I'm privileged. Thank you very much for bringing me into that. I'm a financial consultant, and I'm also a writer, and I'm also a women empowerment coach and speaker. So I guess how I got to get involved with FORP is because of my role as a women empowerment personality, put it that way. It's a journey that I've been through, and I'm still growing. I'm not a politician yet, but I think Auntie has a way of making you, slowly but surely, getting you into that role. She's grooming us. Yes, that's what she's doing. She's grooming us, but I hope police are like watching out. She could be probably arrested someday for grooming people into politics. But that kind of grooming I like. I like so much. Like the Russian people say, I like very much. So thank you, Auntie. So what I do, Women Empowerment, because of my journey, I have been through domestic violence, which is one of the charities Auntie Kate supports. Although I was not in the group where she did that support, it was a different group altogether. So because I've been through that, and I've come out of that, and doing well for myself, I felt the need to be able to help others. So I was put in a position where I could speak up against domestic violence and empower other women. So I run a training where women who've been through domestic violence can come to my training workshop classes and learn strategies that I use to cope and overcome abuse, to be able to rise to the level where I am, I can do the work and help other people. So through that way, supporting them and showing them how to then get involved into or get engaged in a healthy relationship so they don't have to repeat that pattern again. Because so many people do repeat the pattern. They leave one relationship and get into another abusive relationship, or worse, because they haven't learned what to do and what not to do. So this is what I teach them. That's my own way of contributing to the society, to the community, and empowering women to be able to then begin to achieve their dreams and also get onto the ladder of being leaders and even politicians someday. Auntie Kate, take note. So this is what I do. And so I'm here this evening. Before I forget, somebody asked a question from the last panel about young people getting involved in politics. There's a section of FORP called Catch Them Young,
yes, that's right,
which was not mentioned.
Yeah.
We actually cover that for young people. So the whole idea is to reach out to young people and begin to educate them about politics and get them involved at a young age. So it's quite vital that we begin to do that, and FORP is already doing that. If anybody here has any other suggestion of how we can get involved and help young people they think are interested in politics, we'd like to know. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Good evening.
All kings and queens here, HR, protocol observed. Former chair of CNUG, current chair of CNUG, my big sister, Dr. Christina Mutali, my other biggest sister, Aunt Kate. But today, I want to tell you that in the next 2 weeks, you will not be addressing her as Aunt Kate. You will be addressing her as Dr. Kate. Thank you very much. support this worthy cause. I'm privileged to be here, not as a daughter of a Kenyan, but as a daughter of the global village. I have so many titles, one of them now including a Nobel Prize Peace Winner, which I'm very proud of. Many of you may know me as a television producer and presenter at Ben Television, and now also director of corporate strategy at Ben Television. Some of you might know me as founder of BAFTA Awards, which many of you have been honored at BAFTA. Some of you might know me as founder of Mr. Miss East Africa, founder of Global Africa Women's Week, founder of WOW, Women Appreciating Women, a mentor of over 450 young people, and much more. But today, I sit here very proud as the new chair of African, Afro-Caribbean, and Asian Women in Politics. And I humbly accept this post, because with this post, we have a huge task ahead. And I cannot sit on any stage or stand on any stage without giving credit to my father and my mother, who taught me to love humanity, who taught me entrepreneurship, and my father, who was a politician. But as you know, with every politician, they're away from home. And guess what? Guess who takes charge? The mother. So today, I want to give credit to my mother, who taught me the essence of leadership. So please, in her absence, please clap for my mother. As African, Afro-Caribbean, Asian women in politics, we will achieve the following. With the guidance of our founder, Kate, we will make sure that we walk in her footsteps and we practice her ethos. So these are some of the things that we plan to do as of today. Taking over from another big sister of mine who was the former chair. She's not here at the moment, but we're stuck on traffic somewhere. Councillor Susan Fajana Palmer. She did a fantastic job. We should give her also a tribute. We plan to unite and not divide. 100% unite everyone. Every man, every woman, we must unite. We cannot have conversations about women issues in the absence of men. It is time to invite men in these forums so that they know what we are complaining about, what we are being activists about. I know, you know, I'm sorry, he's a very good friend of mine, but I have to point a finger. You know? He needs to understand why women are activists. So if we don't invite him, along with other women, on the round tables, and we become isolated, then they think, you know what, there's an agenda here. You know, feminism should not mean isolating men. You know, it's inclusion. So we plan to unite and not divide. We also plan to, I'm an agent of human love in everything that I do, whether it's business, I run a very successful film studio and other businesses. Human love has to be in the middle of it. Human love has to be in the middle of it, because as we speak now, women in the Congo are being loaded in trucks with their families, crossing over to Angola. Why? Because there's war. Why is there war? Because there's no human love. So we have to practice human love. So with FORB, we promise you that we are going to spread and practice human love. We're also going to solve problems, not create them. We don't want to be part of these problems. Solutions now. It's time for solutions. We've attended many conferences. now high heels, low heels, gowns, short dresses, and everything. It's now time for solutions. We know the problems. Now we want to solve these problems. And very important, we have to encourage women to be on policy making tables, not to be on the side. We are no longer going to be on the side watching. The UN is not going to represent us. The AU is not going to represent us. We are going to use our own voices to be on these tables to represent ourselves. And Kate, I know that that's what you want. That's what you want for every woman, to get her voice back. Because we need to negotiate fair deals for every woman. And when we have a fair deal for every woman, we have a fair deal for every family, we have a fair deal for every nation. And that's what we want. We want also to encourage economic empowerment. Economic empowerment for every woman. We don't want to be going around with begging bowls. No. Money must go around to every family, to every woman. Money must go around. Healthcare for families. Fight injustices. Whether it's domestic violence, child abuse, FGM, discrimination at work, unemployment, we are going to be at the forefront of that. Global education, and encourage women to step confidently in leadership. Do not be apologetic. Leaders are not elected, they're not appointed, they step forward. If you feel that you're a leader, as a woman, you must step forward. Don't wait for someone to point to you. There, you're a leader. We are going to encourage women within the African, Afro-Caribbean, and Asian groups to step forward as leaders. We must make it go viral. And most importantly, mentorship of the young ones. Who are you catching? And that's one program that was started last year, Catching Them Young. So we're going to carry on with that because that's very important. We're also going to practice practical solutions. Now, you know, as I say, you know, we've talked enough, too much talk. Where is the money? Where is the practical solution? I mean, I was at an event today, I told a story very briefly about a woman in the village who was lying in bed for 6 years. She's not related to me. We only discovered her 6 months ago, spinal cord injury. And her 11-year-old daughter was not going to school because she had to look after her. Between me and my mother, we stepped in to look after this woman who we had no affiliation with. Unfortunately, she died on Sunday. Because you know what? The UN did not arrive. The government did not arrive. But between you and me, practical solutions, individual responsibility, we can arrive. And FOB is going to make sure of that. We are going to reach these grassroots people that the big organizations do not reach. So I hope that you are with us in this. I think I'm going to stop there. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Can I now invite questions from the audience? Okay. I'm walking with trepidation.
Thank you for telling me your question. Now, let me say it again. Maybe you misunderstood me. I'm in love with women, first of all. I come from a family where, and I'll tell you why, how. I come from a family where I grew up, we never used to know that women were weak in any way. Because my own mom is, there's no way they're going to be in front of my mom and call her weak. I have sisters. I come from a family. In fact, it was when I grew up that I realized that people were fighting for women's rights. I used to think that women were the stronger gender. That was the kind of, because I was raised by a single mom. So I understand the struggle of women. Now, the point I was trying to make is that we need to be more practical. And there's no way I'm going to joke about this. It's not a matter of joke. It's simply that if we have been trying to solve a problem for several years, for tens of years, using the same method, it's high time we start to change our approach. And all I was saying is that we need to be more practical now. For example, if we want to mobilize women, we have to go out, set up programs. We talk too much. You know, I'm frustrated with the talking. That's honestly the simple truth. And what I've seen in the past, while I was growing up, is that people have used popular language all over the years, and nothing is changing. But now, leadership, when you look around, you even look around this room, the women here are very powerful, strong women. And if we can come together and start to put proper practical actions in place, you will mobilize a lot of women to get into politics. So if we organize an event, an investment summit, and we invite women, let's for example, go to Nigeria to go and bring a billionaire to talk to our women about how they can set up businesses. Are you coming to that kind of summit to talk about how men have oppressed women? No. You will end up not gaining anything from that person. That's the point I was making. So if we're not focused, we're just going to be talking about the same thing, whereas we're not moving. So, and that is what I said about activism. We need to reduce the activism a little bit and get more into action. Because we talk too much. You see, if we continue to talk, we will get nowhere. So you are an MP, for example. How did you get there? Was it that women were fighting for you to become MP? No. You went out to campaign to everybody. So if you go out and you start talking about how women should be allowed to become an MP, honestly, you wouldn't have gotten to that position. That's reality. So we need to change our approach a little bit. Let's be more practical. Let's start to tap into the opportunities that we have and use the we have powerful women that can actually put programs together. And we need people like you in the UK to change the approach a little bit. Because I have daughters. My daughter got first class yesterday. And I'm so proud of her. And she's doing a course that a lot of men will run away from because she chose her course, she chose the university. So, and in my home, I've told my girls, you are not superior to anyone, but you're second to none. As long as we're teaching our women that they're not inferior to anybody, and we start to put practical action in place, we will change the direction of things. Thank you.
I've got someone over here from earlier.
So, I'm not quite sure if everyone knows this, so I introduce myself. My name is Chinela Anyamra. I'm Kate's daughter. Just want to welcome everyone here tonight. My first bit is a comment and then a question. So the comment is just to do with young people in politics. I've kind of been touching on these things the whole night. One of the main things that I think that we could do to get more young people in politics really lies within this room, which is some of you adults that have children. It comes from education from home. Because sometimes for young people, it feels irrelevant to us. And unless at home it's taught in the sense of newspapers, reading, just sitting down and reading the newspaper, understanding what's going on in the world, encouraging young people to watch the news, and have a good understanding of what's not just happening next door, what's happening in the wider community. I think it all stems from the house. And I think from what my mum has done while we were growing up, you know, is to really take on board what's happening in the world and not just what's happening next door. And see how, okay, you may not be able to affect the wider nation, but what can you do in the community? I think growing up, seeing my mum being very active in the community herself and then actually talking to us about what she's doing and how it affects others, and then from that, how a domino effect will help the wider world, really encouraged me to be like, okay, wow, I should be doing something. I should be getting active, because although it's the little, little things that we do, those little, little things are domino effect. As we've seen in the election, where some people may have not thought that young people's vote will really do much when it does. But I think if we can think about what we can do at home with our own children, about educating them on politics and educating them on what's happening, then I think it will help. Because yes, I think social media has played a big, big part in young people getting to what's happening. But also with social media comes propaganda. So, you know, they may not be getting everything they need from social media. They may not be understanding. So I think it's down to the parents to monitor what our children are taking in and really talk to them so that they have a good understanding of what's happening and encourage them. The question comes in the line of, so within politics, we have someone wonderful like Tate to look up to, someone that she's young, she's vibrant, and it's so encouraging because it will make other people from ethnic minorities think, oh wow, a young black female in a position to make a difference. Now my question is, how do anyone on the panel, how do you think more women of ethnic minority can be encouraged? Because I do feel, although yes, there is representation coming up, but I don't feel that there's a lot of young representation interested or there. And I think that moving forward, it will be great. Seeing Kate there is a real encouragement that yes, we can move forward. Yes, there's not barriers. It's for us to kick down the barriers. But how do we do this? Is the question.
Thank you. Coming from someone who is here, I'm going to go directly to the panel to answer. And then, for those of you who are asking questions, I'm going to give priority to those whose voices we haven't heard before.
Like me.
Hey, fantastic questions. So I get your name?
Chinelo.
Chinelo. Chinelo. Fantastic question. Now, I think one of the first things we have to look at is the way that we are defining ourselves. That we're saying that, you know, I'm a young black woman, so other young black women are going to be inspired. That is fantastic to hear, but the party have to look at how they can attract people to actually feel that they want to be an MP or a councillor. And the way that you do that is by having policies or having this manifesto. For once, people are talking about a manifesto, you know, over a general election. Normally, the manifesto, no one talks about it. They're more talking about the individuals, the personalities. And what we've seen over decades is the party has elevated people who don't look like us. And what we need to do as a party is, one, we need to attract young people. So we have to have policies which anybody can stand up and say, I stand for that policy. Yes, we do need to address the fact that there's not enough black women coming through. But I think the party has separated themselves so far from the people who they're supposed to be standing up for. And I hope now we're moving in the direction that more young people of colour, young working class, disabled, whatever, feel they can come forward and say, I want to be an MP or I want to be a councillor, because I feel the party has moved away so far away from the people it was meant to be standing up for. That was a massive void. And with that void, what happened was more people that had gone to Cambridge or Oxford were filling. So I've gone into Parliament, and there is very few people on both sides of the benches that sound like me, look like me, went to my university. I went to East London University. I didn't go to Cambridge. I didn't go to Oxford. I studied international development. You know, I worked in the voluntary sector. I was a single mother. You know, there isn't many people in Parliament like me. But hopefully now, one, people want to be part of the party and join. And secondly, more people that look like me, like yourself, feel like there's a place for them on the benches. So we have to open up the discussion and not make it be so personal about, oh, me, I'm a black woman. You know, because when you get in there, there's not many people that look or sound like us. But it doesn't mean we shouldn't be there. Mm-hmm. So it's a fine balance. But all I'm trying to say is we mustn't romanticize the fact that just because you look a certain way, that when you enter into a room, everyone's going to accept you for that. You actually have to do a lot more. And part of that is having a party which you can be proud of and say, well, I'm actually standing up to say, all young people coming from my background should go to university, shouldn't have to pay. Or, you know, young children should go to school and have a hot meal. Old people shouldn't have to sell their homes when they're old. You know, these are the things the party needs to be doing to attract people, and then has to accept that we need to do more to proactively have a way of ensuring that people that look and sound like us can get through.
I would like to add, answer some of the questions, well, the questions there. Firstly, I'd like to say that mentorship is key in getting women into politics, because some women who secretly want to get into there don't even have a clue how to get started. Just like Auntie Kay, she has to go and ask questions. But some women who don't even know what kind of questions to ask. A few weeks ago, I called up Auntie Kay because I have a young man at home who understands Brexit more than I do, literally. I'm sure some people here don't actually quite understand what Brexit means, really. But he does. He explained to me what it means to be in Europe or out of Europe. How about that? So he was going on about certain policies, the election. So he was driving me crazy. I said, I'm going to call Auntie Kate. I don't have a clue what you're talking about, young man, but I know somebody who does. So I called up Auntie and said, Auntie, please, here's this man. Talk to him. He probably is interested in politics. I don't have a clue. Please tell him how to get started. So I think mentorship is key, because there are people who want to get started but don't have a clue how to get started. So if there's a way you can organize, Auntie, maybe you and this Kate here know how to probably put a mentorship program together where young people, not just black women, but young men as well, to get into politics, for them to know how to reach you all and where to get started. I think that would be quite helpful. Also, I believe from our community, there are women who really should be in politics, in political like arena, doing great work, but they find themselves in community groups fighting for posts. Really, I'm sorry, but I'm thinking you shouldn't be fighting one another for little posts in your community because you are bigger than that. They are so big that they want to do something greater, but they're not sure how to get started. Please do not be afraid to ask Auntie Kate or anybody you know, how do I get started? Because there's enough room, there's enough position to go around. If we only know how to get engaged, to only know how to get involved, to only know how to ask the right questions to get started. Third point I'd like to add to this is that, again, women have to support women, because it's good to talk about it. But then some women do not want other women to progress. Am I right? Or am I right? Yes, we all want to see women there. But when a woman decides, I want to be there, I need your support, how many genuinely do come out and support that woman? Yes, I'm asking you, the audience, do you believe, is this true or is it true? So we all have one voice. We have this, that's a serious problem we as black people need to really face and address. It is true. So how now do we overcome this secret, crab in the bucket? How do we stop pulling each other down, even though we want to get up there? If you think your sister who wants to be up there is not qualified to be up there, how about you find, if you think you're qualified to be up there, how can we help that person get up there instead of trying to pull them down? So women have to start supporting women a lot more to actually achieve the same goal that we all want, or else we all remain there in the bucket. Nobody will actually climb up and become successful. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much to the great teacher, Ms. Kate, and Felicity. As you know, before, we are now focusing on solutions. And I'd like to just publicly declare that FORP membership is free. It's free for yourselves, it's free for your children, it's free for the young ones. So we are focusing on solutions. I know your daughter was asking, that's the question you're answering. How do they get in? So it's free. And with FORP, we are going to offer training to get into politics. As you know, our founder, Dr. Kate, is a midwife by profession. Anyone can get into politics. Even if you're a street sweeper, you can find yourself as an MP or a councillor with training that FORP is going to provide. Do not shy away from politics, because everything is politics. What's in the home is politics. We have seen what's happened in Grenfell fire. May they rest in peace. That was politics. Yes. That is politics. What's happening in the schools is politics. What's happening in NHS is politics. What's happening in the supermarket is politics. So everything is politics. So we must catch our children young, the young people, and tell them everything is politics. And FORP is a forum where we are going to be training people to get into politics. Thank you.
Thank you. I know there's quite a few questions. Before, we're just going to have two more questions. And the only, wait. Before, I've just been told that if you want any more food, please help yourself, because they'll be clearing it up shortly. Me too. Yes. So there's a. So I'm going to. All right. So I'm told that when you ask your question, I'm only asking two people. Someone's just. There's a lady there who was. Had her hands up earlier, and I've just been told by Antipate that the person next to you, when you ask your question, please direct it to somebody.
Thank you very much. My name is Rasia Hamid. I'm a solicitor, and I also run Wages, Women and Girls in Government Group, a charity, and we got many awards from different councils. And right now, we are running a global peace campaign in all over the UK. And we also got many awards for our peace campaign. So I just want to know the politics, the image went. Because I'm a solicitor and I was a victim of violence after 11 years, my long year fight with the Home Office, I got indefinitely on my domestic violence. So I had been through very, very hard time. And because I'm scared, I want to join politics, I'm scared from my back home country politics. And here, you know, too much talked of and being a single lady, oh my Lord, what people will think, you know, have to. I'm so scared to join the politics. I'm a very active lady, but at the same time, I'm scared to join the politics because, you know, so many things happen in politics, party clashes, and your attacks on you, and some bad fighting, you know, dirty play, something you have to. So, is UK, is the same game is happening or not? It's not yet the same thing.
One more question, and then the only person I'm allowed to answer is the one politician in the midst, and then that's it. I'm really sorry.
No, what about me?
Sorry,
I apologize.
We are
Distinguished guests here, my name is Dr. Bobad Douglas. I'm the new chairman of the Central Association of Nigerians in the United Kingdom. I just like to take a cue from the former chair of KANU here, Chief Limbo. Recently, we paid a courtesy call at the High Commission, and the new newly elected Executive Council, you know, visited the High Commission, and we all lined up. And someone said something about the Millennium Goals and so on. And the ambassador there turned around and said, excuse me, you have about 12 members in the Executive Council, and 8 of you are women. So, I mean, you've gone more, I mean, higher and above what is expected. So, sincerely, women are going places. I'd just like to congratulate our sister Kate Osamu for what you've achieved. Please give her a round of applause. And thank you so much, Dr. Kate, for all the wonderful job you're doing. Thank you so much.
Okay, can we have a question? That wasn't a question.
What is
a question?
Well, you want a question?
What?
Right, the question is, how are you coping within an environment with so many men, and most of them are probably in their 60s? So how do you cope within the parliament? That's what I have to ask.
Razia, the question that you have just posed is really, really interesting, because when I go out knocking on doors, there are many people in Edmonton that support Labour, but because of where they come from, they don't want to put up the posters in their windows. Because back home, when you identify supporting a certain party, it can bring violence to you. And that is a big fear. In the UK, there is a lot of backbiting and, you know, this, that, and the other. This one says this, someone goes on TV, says something bad about someone else. But in the main, it's safe. So you can join, you can get involved, nothing will happen to you. Might be a bit of shouting in a meeting, but that's about it. It's not like back home where you could, you know, in all seriousness, lose your life for being affiliated to a certain party. It's very different. So please join, get involved. You're very welcome. Yeah?
Easy one.
What I'd like to say to everybody in this room, I know you all think I'm really, really young. I'm not as young as I look. Okay? How old are you? I'm a lot older. Maybe your age. I'm a lot older. No, I'm a lot older than what I look. So I appreciate that you think I'm really young. Obviously, I have my mindset might be quite younger than yourselves, but I'm not young in age. Yeah, I'm a lot older. Do you want me to say how old I am?
No.
Yes.
I know what you are trying to ask, and it's a very interesting question, but it is a little bit patronizing that you think that a woman can't manage around men. We can.
Old men
as well. We can. Because the purpose of me being in Parliament is not to be worrying about older men around me, it's about representing Edmonton and getting my voice heard and understanding the mechanisms within Parliament and being a legislator. So my fundamental dream would be to be in Parliament and to be in government. That's what I'm there for, not to be worrying about all the old men and that's no consequence to me.
Thank you. So thank you very much to the panel. Yes, I know there are people. Let me tell you what it's like. So I have one ear, people are saying, why can't I ask more questions? And then I have on the other ear, someone saying, we want to finish, we want to dance. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So, we're out of time according to my time, so I'm really sorry for those who are not able to ask questions. And for me, what it says is, it means this conversation can carry on when we're later, or even amongst ourselves. So I want to thank the panel. I want to thank all three of you, and I would please ask you to do this by shaking a round of applause.
But one thing is very, very important to me. Looking at young Kate here, here, I always say that when I look at people like her, she is that woman I would have loved to be, but I didn't have anyone directing me. Whatever I know today, whatever I have done for myself, I did it my own way. I learned, I read Evening Standard, I watched television. When I heard about events, sometimes I turned up, I was the only black woman there. I didn't even know why I was there, but I wanted to be somewhere. And why was that? My grandmother, a complete illiterate, she was an activist. Whenever there was a PDP, PNPN, and all the political parties, and they needed to mobilize women, they went to her. She had a voice. And I learned to speak for myself, and I saved my mind. And I think because I saved my mind too much, I was kicked out anyway, but it's okay. So after a while, I realized that it has taken me a very long time to get to where I was, where I wanted to be, and where I still want to go. And I thought to myself, if it took me that long, there must be other women who are going making that journey. Since I have made my journey and I'm a little comfortable where I was then, it might be necessary to bring women together and tell them about my journey. And if my journey and the experience I have had can actually cut short that end journey, this trouble about women development, women empowerment, will start to be heard and the journey will be cut short. So we decided to set up the Nigerian Women in Diaspora Leadership Forum. And when we did, we had great response. People came along and we started talking, mentoring and having seminars. I realized as well that when we set up, majority of the groups we had were professional women's group, which I believe segregated. And a lot of us do not have the confidence. There are still places that when I want to go, I need someone to hold my hand to give me the confidence to go there. So we started seminars we called Every Woman Leadership Forum, because we believe that every woman is a leader. If you're selling pepper in Peckham Market, you are a woman leader teaching people how to sell pepper. It might be somebody's ambition or aspiration to become a pepper seller in market. You will lead that section and tell them what to do. So we invited everybody on board, and it has worked out. Kate mentioned something that is very, very important, and also Bimbo talked about it. We keep talking about women in the world. We're supposed to have more women than men. But why do we still have more men in leadership than women? The truth is that women don't support each other. A lot of us have come to believe that leadership is the domain of men. And because it's a man or man only thing, whenever I show my face and say, I really would like to be a counselor, everybody thinks, this Jennifer, she's too bold for her own boots. Pull her down. And you forget something. As you're pulling me down, somebody else is watching you pull me down. And when you want to do something that is very special to you or important to the community, they will do the same thing. And when they pull you down and then we keep pulling each other down, how are we going to do it? So one big thing is lack of presentation. If I want something, I ask for it. If I don't get it, I move on. I go to the next one until I get what I want. So I think that women must learn to begin to ask. And you keep asking. I listened to a pastor and she said, if you need something, ask. If you don't get it, demand. And if you don't demand, kick. If you don't get it, kick open the door, and then if it's not there, move on, go to the next one. So don't take no for an answer. And when we talk about it, we need mentoring. And when you talk about mentoring, there are so many women here who can mentor other women. But the truth is, if I'm prepared to mentor you, are you prepared to have me mentor you? Are you prepared to believe me? Are you going to be in competition with me? We've competed so much and for so long, we can't continue this way. The way I'm looking at it, Ketan Olo may be the perfect writer in this room. The young kids could be the best speaker in this room. And the rest of us are cheerleaders. Why don't we cheer kids to write? And we give to this young kid to read. And whenever we go anywhere and people see us, they say, oh, don't mess with them. Because if you need a writer, they've got one. If you need a speaker, they've got one. And that is the only way women can survive. So based on that, I need to actually wrap up. Somebody said something about, Kate said something that we need men to actually be who we want to be. Just like I thought about Nigerian women in diaspora, I have been thinking about how we can actually get more men involved. I thought to myself, so much has been said, So much has been done, so much has been achieved, so much remains to be achieved, and so much remains to be said. But we can't continue talking about the same thing over and over again. There must be something that we are missing. And I thought to myself, what we are missing is men. We need men talking about women development. If we keep talking about it, my ex-husband, if she sees me in if he saw me in FOP, that would be big backlash home. He will beat the living hell out of me because I'm going to learn from these mad women who are trying to kill their husbands. They want to take power from other men. And I tell you, there are still men in our world who still think that way. So because of this, I have also decided to start a new initiative. I've called it He for She Heroes. And these He for She Heroes, basically what I want to do, I want to approach all the men in our community. I want to approach men in workplaces and say, look, if you support women development, join us. If you join us, we will recognize you. You tell us what you have done. And that will encourage other people to begin to think about supporting women. So we have decided that on the 14th of October this year, we are going to have a He for She Heroes Award and Recognition Night. And it will be an opportunity to encourage and applaud men who have been supporting women and help other men to come along. So if it's your brother, your father, your sister, your uncle, or any friend who has been supporting you, and because of him you are the woman you think you are, let us know about him. We will recognize him. Because with me, as a young woman, I would say, Daddy, I'm going to climb that tree. He'll be having his cigarette, he's not even looking. And he goes, Pet, I know you can do that. And that used to be a big challenge to me because I was looking at my father to say, oh, you can't do it. But my dad would just look at what I said, but Pet, you can do more. So there are men in our world today who are saying to women, you can do more. Let's recognize them, let's make them proud, and help them to help other men to understand that this is necessary and it can be done. And we're talking about women, sorry, there's something that kids, why are women not adequately represented in leadership? As I said before, we need to begin to present. We have all these people here. FOP is for all of us. We have Catch Them Young. Talk to your young children about being leaders. And being leaders does not mean necessarily going to the House of Parliament to become a parliamentarian. You can be a leader wherever you are. So I'm asking everyone here to please support this new initiative, He for She Heroes. It is something we want to do. We want to hold hands. We want to talk to everybody. We want to reach every woman. And I'm saying again, Auntie Kate, thank you very much. You've done so well. You've opened the door. The rest is for us to do, women. This is your opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jenny. We've come to that part of the evening where I hope you've got your dancing shoes. DJ, are you ready? So, dance, dance, dance.
Ladies and gentlemen, could I just very quickly recognize the presence of the first vice chair and second vice chair of KANU, Roque and Emmy Benson. Please give them a good round of applause. Thank you.
With us if you want us to broadcast your event as it's happening live all over the world. We were yesterday at the Nursing Association. We're also here now at the Women's Matter, where we now came down to women in politics in the 21st century. The most important thing is, again, as usual, my name is Olayomi Koiki, Niger Diaspora, one central hub, connecting the Nigerians, not just here in UK, but globally as well. You've heard it all from the Member of Parliament, Kate Osamo. How do you encourage the women to get involved in politics? The most important thing is mentorship. A lot of hard work has to be done around that as well. Also, you must also get involved in politics, because politics is one of the most important things that dictates everything that we do in life. You know, whether you live in the United Kingdom, whether you live in Nigeria, whether you live in Kenya, Uganda, wherever you are all over the world, politics is a very, very important thing that every one of us must get involved in. Most important thing is we must encourage ourselves, you know, for those of you living in the United Kingdom, also for those of you living outside the country. Again, as usual, we're bringing it to you as it's happening. Sometimes it takes a long day, sometimes it takes long hours, but the most important thing is we must continue to make sure that we give it to you as it's happening. If you want us to be part of your event, make sure you get in touch with us, yomi@nigeriadiaspora.net. Also, join me every Wednesday between the hours of 7 p.m. to 9 p.m., where we bring different context. You know, this coming Wednesday, we'll be bringing to you, you know, Samuel Estate, where she'll be able to tell us, you know, the effect of you living in a housing, whether you're a landlord. Also, Dear Oba Authentic music will be coming out tomorrow. The snips, we've been sending it out tomorrow, the 25th of June 2017. We're also using this opportunity to say to all the Muslim brothers that are watching all over the world, the Ramadan has finished, but remember the rituals of what actually happened within the 30 days that you were fasting. Let us continue to love each other. Remember all the good things you've done during the Ramadan. Now that the Ramadan has finished, make sure you continue as well. Also, we're using this opportunity to send a big love to everybody all over the world that has been following us. We had about 4,000 people that were watching us live yesterday. Again, as usual, it can only be done by you, not by us. You tell us where it's happening, and we make sure we bring it to you. Also, let's continue to remember those that lost their lives at the Grenfell Tower. As you can see, this is now becoming a big, major issue, because just only last night, some residents were evacuated, you know, from where they were residing yesterday. The most important thing is we must continue to bring peace, regardless of whatever the problem is. I see you as you're watching me. Again, as usual, we'll be calling off very soon. I'm going to go back inside and show you a little bit of those that are dancing, having a good time. But I'm sure you've learned one or two things. But tomorrow, we'll be bringing something different next week. Thank you very much for joining us, as usual. And like I said, if you want us to be part of your event, if you've got something you want to promote, you want Niger Diaspora to get involved, to be your media partner, we're also still looking for those that can sponsor the program on a Wednesday between the hours of 7 p.m. and 9 p.m. Again, as usual, my name is Olayomi Koike, and thank you very much for joining us at this very long journey that has taken place from Women's Matter up to the politics, women in politics in the 21st century. We're going to go back into the hall and show you a little bit more people dancing, and we're calling it off tonight, where we'll be back again next week. Thank you very much. back again next week.